Hello and welcome to this channel. My name is Victoria and in this video we will talk about carcinomas of the uterus. First about endometrial carcinomas and then about myometrial sarcomas. Endometrial carcinomas are the most frequent malignant disease of the female reproductive tract. And today we will talk about the different types of carcinomas, risk factors, how to diagnose and treat it, and a few things more that might be important to know. The average age of diagnosis is 68 years, so in postmenopausal women. In women in the reproductive period, or maybe even younger, it is seen rarely, but of course not never. The risk factor for this malignancy we divide into endogenous and exogenous factors. Endogenous factors include obesity, diabetes mellitus, having an early menarche, so the first menstruation happened at around 12 years or earlier, also having a late menopause, polycystic ovarian syndrome, and low parity, so having no or maybe one child. Exogenous risk factors are those that are not coming from our body itself, as for example, non-cyclic solitary estrogen replacement therapy for postmenopausal women, tamoxifen therapy, and the previous radiation therapy. So having had a malignancy before that was treated by radiation also predisposes for the development of endometrial carcinoma. Now I want to mention the different types of endometrial carcinoma. We differentiate two types, depending on what role estrogen plays in their development. Type 1 is the estrogen-related type. It usually originates from a hyperplastic endometrium and makes up 75 to 80% of endometrial cancer cases. It is usually well differentiated, so the neoplastic cells resemble the original endometrial cells well, which usually goes hand in hand with a better prognosis. It also generally grows slowly. As said earlier, it is linked to excessive estrogen in the body, and it is usually less likely to metastasize. The most common subtype is the endometrioid adenocarcinoma. Type 2 is the estrogen unrelated type. It originates from atrophic endometrium and makes up only around 10 to 15% of cases. This type of carcinoma is more often poorly differentiated and so has often a worse prognosis. This type includes uterine serous carcinomas and clear cell carcinomas. In the next part of the video, I want to talk about the growth of the carcinomas. Mostly they originate in the fundal part of the uterus. We can differentiate if the tumor grows towards the uterine cavity, then we call the growth exophytic, or if it grows towards the myometrium, then we call it endophytic. Even though the carcinoma often originates in the fundus, it can grow towards the cervix, which it can occlude in some cases, leading to hematometra, which means that the uterus is filled with menstrual blood. In around 10% of cases, the growth also reaches neighboring structures, as the parametrium, the vagina, or the pelvic lymph nodes. Only in roughly 5% a hematogenous spread to the lungs, liver, and bones occur. The next point is the staging of endometrial carcinomas. We can either stage them by the classical TNM staging, where T stands for tumor growth, N for lymph node involvement, and M for metastasis. Or we can use the staging provided by the International Federation of Gynecology and Obstetrics, short FIGO. The FIGO classification is mostly congruent with the T part of the TNM classification, as they both describe the depth of tissue involvement of the tumor at its primary site. A T1 or FIGO1 indicates that the growth of the tumor is restricted to the uterine corpus. In T2 or FIGO2, the tumor infiltrates the cervix. In T3 or FIGO3, the tumor has already spread to the neighboring structures, and in the final stage, T4 or FIGO4, the tumor has spread beyond the true pelvis or pelvis minor and affects adjacent organs such as the intestines and urinary bladder. The next point I want to talk about is the symptoms that a patient might experience. The primary symptom for endometrial carcinomas is bleeding. As mentioned earlier, the primary age group that is affected is postmenopausal women. So every bleeding in postmenopausal women should be examined. As in 50% of postmenopausal women, a bleeding is indicative of endometrial carcinoma, compared to only 5% in premenopausal women. We can classify the bleeding in premenopausal women in menorrhagia, meaning longer and more heavy menstruation than usually, and metrorrhagia, which is a bleeding within the menstrual cycle besides the regular menses. Also, an important point to note is that every fifth carcinoma, so 20%, are completely asymptomatic. So women should be advised to go to their regular gynecological checkup also after family planning has been completed or menopause has been reached. Other suspicious symptoms include a painful or non-painful mass in the pelvic area, unintended weight loss, and painful urination or intercourse. The diagnosis of endometrial carcinomas is usually done by a gynecological examination upon bleeding to identify the source. Also, a transvaginal sonography can be done to evaluate the endometrium and the pelvis, and in some cases, the gynecologist has to perform an abrasion, hysteroscopy, or an MRI with contrast media. The therapy depends on the stage of the cancer and the age of the patient. Classically, it is either surgical removal followed by radiation therapy or primary radiation therapy. Usually the radical hysterectomy, which is the surgical procedure, has a better prognosis, but in some cases a surgery is contraindicated. That usually depends on the general health status of the patient and concomitant diseases. The 5-year survival rate depends on the stage, but not only the stage alone. Also the histologic type and the estrogen dependency play a role. In stage 1, the 5-year survival rate is approximately 85%, compared to only 20% in stage 4. The grading or aggressiveness of the tumor also should be considered. Usually the better differentiated the cells are, the better the prognosis. Better differentiation means that the tumor cells look pretty much exactly like the healthy cells, while in poorly differentiated, tumor cells look very different, as the tumor is proliferating at a fast rate and does not take the time, basically, to form properly matured and well-formed cells. In a grade 1 tumor, which is a well-differentiated one, 95% of the cancer tissue is forming glands. In grade 2, between 50 and 94% of the tissue is forming glands, and in grade 3, less than half of the tumor forms glands. In the next part of the video, we will talk about sarcomas. First, a short revision of the pathological basis of sarcomas. A sarcoma is a malignant tumor that arises from mesenchymal cells. It can contain bone, hematopoietic tissue, cartilage, and adipose tissue. It is usually arising within connective or muscle tissue and has usually very little connective tissue stroma. The tumor is often poorly differentiated, so generally has a quite bad prognosis. The uterine sarcoma can be found within the Mullerian system, including the endometrial stroma and myometrium. The embryonal Mullerian ducts form the fallopian tubes, the uterus, the cervix, and the superior aspect of the vagina, so those are the places we can find a uterine sarcoma in. In a mixed Mullerian sarcoma, we can find tissues within the tumor that are generally not supposed to be in the uterus, as for example bone formations. The uterine sarcomas make up less than 1 in 20 uterine malignancies, and it is prevalent in the age of 40 to 60. A predisposing factor is previous radiation therapy and tamoxifen therapy, while oral contraceptive use is associated with a reduction of risk. The next point I want to talk about are the symptoms. Classical symptoms are, as in endometrial carcinomas, bleeding and the passage of tissue through the cervical canal, metrorrhagia, the finding of an abdominal or pelvic mass, which might or might not be painful, and enlargement of the uterus. Diagnosis of uterine sarcoma is rarely made before surgery. The tumor often appears soft and fleshy, and the color can vary from gray over yellow to pink, depending on the tissue it forms. It can also present with necrosis, hemorrhages, and vascular invasion. In histologic examination of the biopsy, we can find cellular atypia, increased mitotic figures, hyperchromasia, and a disturbed cytoplasmic nuclear ratio. To keep in mind is that a pap smear is often negative. The next point is the treatment of uterine sarcomas. We can remove the tumor surgically, after which usually radiation therapy follows. Radiation therapy can also be used alone, either internally or externally, and also progestin can be used as a hormone therapy. The last point I want to talk about is the staging and prognosis. In stage 1, the tumor is limited to the myometrium. In stage 2, it has progressed to the cervix and the connective tissue of the cervix. In stage 3, the progression has already led beyond the uterus, but it is still limited to the pelvis. And at stage 4, the tumor spreads to neighboring and distant sites, as the bladder, intestines, and various lymph nodes. Unfortunately, the prognosis of uterine sarcoma is rather poor. The average 5-year survival rate for early stages is only around 50%, while for advanced stages it is estimated to be around 10%. That's it for this topic. I hope it was interesting for you. And if you like our channel, please subscribe. Thank you very much.